qu'il n'y a personne qui est meilleur que moi pour ces histoires-là. Et là, on est rendu au deuxième montage. L'audience de Kimberly Chattel devant la Chambre des représentants au niveau de l'assassinat. Sortez les super chats, faut faire cracher du cash à François Aubé, FA Construction, à commercial@hotmail.ca pour des contrats de rénovation viriliste. Donc envoyez des super chats et on se voit dans une quarantaine de minutes.
My name is Kimberly Chattel and I'm the director of the United States Secret Service. I appreciate the opportunity to appear before you today. The assassination attempt of former President Donald Trump on July 13th is the most significant operational failure of the Secret Service in decades, and I am keeping him and his family in my thoughts.
Well, they wanted to put me on a stretcher. They had a stretcher, and they wanted to put me on a stretcher, and I said, I'm not going on a stretcher, because I just felt it was the ear, and there was a lot of blood coming. I don't know if you've heard this, but the ear causes, they say, the most in the body. You get hit in the ear. Better than just about any other place in one way, but in another way, it bleeds more. And there was a lot of blood, but I understood. They thought I was hit elsewhere. They thought I was hit actually in this area. And I wasn't. I said, I'm telling you, I'm okay. I'm fine. I'm going to get up. I want to get up. I'm not going to be taken out on a stretcher. We had a little argument. Well, I have six guys lying on top of me. I mean, I had some big guys on top of me.
Yeah.
Strong guys, too. I can tell you that by the wrist. The wrist had a little work on it. And brave guys, because they ran onto that stage very quickly. I was down for the most part, because when I looked at my hand, I knew it was something very serious. I put my hand up. I looked at it. It had blood all over it. But I had a lot of big, strong humans on top of me. And they were very brave humans, because they were running into fire. And he kept going. He probably thought he hit, but it hit the ear. And when I saw that, I got down pretty quickly, I think. I also think people were starting to shout. It's one of the reasons I was able to go down so fast, because it almost is amazing that move of checking here and going almost immediately down. I think so. Probably people were shouting at the same time. Who knows? It was bedlam. And I was down, and I said, let's get going. Come on, let's go. It just shouldn't have been when you have essentially a flat, open roof like that, and it's direct to the target with absolutely nothing in its way. How can somebody be up there? And he was up there for a long period of time, because they have tape of him moving all over the place. And then they see him, and they don't report him. Who was the policeman, or the, I guess it was local police, who looked at him, saw him standing with a gun? I think the guy saw him, and this guy dropped off the roof. And I don't blame him for that. What I do blame him for is why isn't he calling everybody, screaming and saying, there's a guy with a gun up there. What did he do when he dropped off the roof? Did he just go away and say, like, nothing? That's a big, you know, that's a big factor. Who was he? And why did he do that? Why didn't we know about that? Because I would have, you know, oftentimes, based on weather and based on other things, I'd say, sir, would you wait 10 minutes before you go out, please? We never had a case like this. But certainly if they said, would you wait 5, 10, 15, 20 minutes, because we have a possible problem, unlikely but possible. I wish somebody would have done that, because Corey would be alive and two people that were seriously hurt would not be hurt. And we wouldn't have had all of the things that we've gone through over the last period of time.
And sir, I think it illustrates
the annual budget of around $3.1 billion, and I believe around 8,000 employees. Is that correct?
Yes, sir.
Obviously, there were many security failures on the day of the attempted assassination and leading up to that day. Let's start with the building that the shooter used to shoot President Trump from. At any point Saturday, did the Secret Service have an agent on top of that roof?
Sir, I'm sure as you can imagine that we are just 9 days out from this incident, and there's still an ongoing investigation. And so I want to make sure that any information that we are providing to you is factual.
You can't, okay. Why did the Secret Service not, can you answer why the Secret Service didn't place a single agent on the roof?
We are still looking into the advanced process and the decisions that were made.
Okay. Wasn't that building within the perimeter that should be secured? Do we agree with that?
The building was outside of the perimeter on the day of the visit. But again, that is one of the things that during the investigation we want to take a look at and determine whether or not other decisions should have been made.
One of the things that you said, I believe, in an interview, that there wasn't an agent on the roof because it was a slope roof. Is that normal? And do you fear that that immediately creates an opportunity for future would-be assassins to look for a slanted roof? I mean, this is a huge question that every American has. Why wasn't a Secret Service agent on the roof? And there have been reports that agents were supposed to be on the roof, but it was hot that day and they didn't want to be on the roof. Can you answer any of those questions, Director?
So I appreciate you asking me that question, Chairman. I should have been more clear in my answer when I spoke about where we placed personnel in that interview. What I can tell you is that there was a plan in place to provide overwatch, and we are still looking into responsibilities and who was going to provide overwatch. But the Secret Service in general, not speaking specifically to this incident, when we are providing overwatch, whether that be through counter snipers or other technology, prefer to have sterile rooftops.
Did the Secret Service use any drones for surveillance that day?
So again, I'm not going to get into specifics of that day in itself, but there are times during a security plan that the Secret Service does deploy an asset like a drone.
There were reports that the shooter used a drone just a few hours before the rally start time. Is that accurate?
I have heard those same reports, and again, am waiting for the final report.
Do you know, if you can't answer the question, that's your answer. But can you answer this? Do you know, I'm not asking yes or no, but do you know if the shooter used a drone before the shooting?
That information has been passed to us from the FBI.
How many Secret Service agents were assigned to President Trump on the day of the rally?
Again, I'm not going to get into the specifics of the numbers of personnel that we had there, but we feel that there was a sufficient number of agents assigned.
There are reports that several agents assigned to the rally on July 13th were temporary agents, agents not normally assigned to President Trump. Is that accurate?
What I can tell you is that the agents that were assigned to former President Trump are Secret Service agents that provide close protection to him, and that was what was actual on that day.
How many temporary agents were there that day?
Quite frequently, sir, during campaign events, the Secret Service utilizes agents from HSI or the Department of Homeland Security.
You don't know how many?
Supplement
you can't answer
our plan.
Had the investigators reconstructed the shooter's precise movements over the past days, weeks, and months?
So, again,
we need to have confidence that if the FBI is leading this investigation, that they're leading a credible investigation, because there's some of us sitting up here today that don't have a lot of confidence in the FBI. So I will repeat the question. Have the investigators reconstructed the shooter's precise moments over the past days, weeks, and months?
I understand your question, Chairman, and I share your concerns about wanting to make sure that we have factual information. The FBI is conducting a criminal investigation. The Secret Service is conducting an internal investigation. There are a number of OIG investigations, and there is the external investigation that the President
Last
initiated.
Question for me. Before July 13th, had the Trump detail requested additional resources?
What I can tell you is that for the event on July 13th, the details that were the assets that were requested for that day were given.
Okay. My time has expired. Chair now recognizes ranking member asking for 5 minutes.
Did he have a range finder? There were some reports that the individual had a range finder. That would certainly raise my suspicion. Did he have a range finder?
Yes, he did. But may I explain that at a number of our sites, especially when you're at outdoor venues, a range finder is not a prohibited item. It is sometimes an item that is brought in by individuals if you're going to be in the back.
Did anybody confront him on that? Anybody ask him questions? What are you doing with the range finder? Anybody confront him on his presence where he was in proximity to the president?
So again, to my knowledge, I believe that was the process that was taking place, was to locate the individual.
Did they confront him? Did they go up to him? Did they talk to him?
I do not have those details at this time.
Those are important details.
So far, you gave a lame excuse for sloped roof. You said that local law enforcement's job was to cover up the building before backtracking on that. We were told that President Trump's team did not ask for security before you backtracked on that. You haven't provided the audio recording that this committee, the chairman, requested that it was due Thursday. You didn't give us an advance copy of your opening statement, but yet there was reporting on it somewhere else. There seems to be more information from YouTube videos than you're able to provide for us, and it begs the question to anyone, you're in charge of the investigation of your own failure. So how is anybody in America supposed to be able to trust the results of that investigation as being anything transparent and genuine?
That's the last question, but please feel free to answer the question, Director.
Sir, I've been a Secret Service agent for nearly 30 years. I have led with integrity, and I follow our core values of duty, justice, honor, loyalty, and courage. And I am doing that in this case, and I assure this committee that I will provide answers when we have a full and complete report. In addition to cooperating...
Director, real quick, at what time was Secret Service aware of the active threat against President Trump? Director? What time?
So the Secret Service was aware that there was an individual who had been identified as suspicious, and that individual was attempting to be tracked down.
At what time?
I don't have a specific timeline other than to tell
Director,
you,
it's been 9 days.
I understand
at what
that.
Time?
I want to make sure that I give you factual information, sir.
Director, have you talked to the agents on the ground that day?
Yes, I have.
You've talked to all of them?
Mm-hmm.
Your senior team has talked to every agent that was on the ground that day.
Yes, we have.
Have they all corroborated the same time they identified the shooter or they were made aware of the shooter, either by attendees in the crowd or a local police department?
There are a number of reports of when those times were made.
Was it 5 minutes before the first shot rang out?
No.
Generally speaking, was it 10 minutes before the first shot rang out?
No,
it was it 15 minutes before the first shot rang out?
It was less than that time frame when it was identified as a threat.
How many days before the shooting took place did Secret Service actually do their advance work to secure the facility that the rally was going to be held at?
5 days.
In the 5 days prior, when the security advance team did their work, did they identify the rooftop as a potential threat?
Again, I'm pulling those reports and that information.
It's been 9 days, Madam Director. Did they notice a rooftop 150 yards away that was a potential threat? Yes or no?
I am certain that the rooftop was noticed. I am pulling the reports.
What was the security the security parameters around securing that rooftop? What did they do?
There was overwatch provided for that rooftop.
Did overwatch fail?
I am waiting to hear what the results of the investigation were so that I can identify where the failure was.
Who did you talk to that was on the ground that day that was responsible for overwatch? What are their names?
I'm not going to provide their names in this setting.
Did you talk to the people that were providing overwatch that day?
I've talked to the people that conducted the advance on that day and that were working the shift and were the counter snipers on that day.
So you talked to the counter sniper team, you talked to the people who were providing overwatch that day, and you talked to the advance team, correct?
Yes, sir.
What did they tell you?
We are putting together a comprehensive report so that I can identify exactly where the gaps and the failures.
When the counter sniper team was on the roof and they identified that there was suspicious activity on the roof in question, what was the chain of command's orders around the person on said roof? Because I'm quite sure somebody saw in under your organization, the Secret Service, I'm quite sure somebody saw the shooter on the roof. So what was the communication through the chain of command to deal with said person?
What I can tell you is that when the individual was identified by the counter sniper, they took one shot and neutralized that individual.
But that was after the shooter already took a shot, is that correct?
That is correct.
So what you're saying now is that the Secret Service did not see the shooter on the roof until after the shooter took a shot?
I do not have all of those details at this time.
If you don't have those details after 9 days, Director, then what you're telling me is that you guys didn't see it. Is that correct?
I am telling you I don't have all the details of the sequence at this time.
Director, it's been 9 days. Either you have the information or you do not. Is that correct?
We are still in the process of conducting interviews and an investigation.
Some of my colleagues have texted me over the last couple days, bipartisan, about whether you should lose your job. And I've been quiet on that question because I wanted to see what you were going to do today. In my opinion, you do need to be fired immediately. And it is because this is gross incompetence. And the fact that it's been 9 days, and these are simple questions to answer. I'm quite sure if I asked any one of my kids if they got in trouble and I told them to give me the details, I would get more answers from them than I'm getting from you right now. And that's what's frustrating on a bipartisan basis, on a nonpartisan basis. This is a joke. And Director, you're in charge. And that's why you need to go. Mr. Chairman, I yield back.
Gentleman yields back. Chair now recognizes Mr. Fallon from Texas.
How did a 20-year-old loner with a week's notice pick the absolute best location to assassinate President Trump when the entire Secret Service missed it? Director Cheadle, in your leadership, your agency got outsmarted and outmaneuvered by a 20-year-old. How can we have any confidence that you could stop a trained professionals from a nefarious nation state?
Those are absolutely questions that we need to have.
I know they're questions, but the fact of the matter is we can't have that confidence. Director, do you have the ability personally, and do you have the authority to beef up security of any of your protectees?
Yes, I do.
Okay. So were you also aware there was a credible threat President Trump was facing? He was facing a heightened security threat to a foreign adversary?
Yes.
Okay. So given that there was an increased threat to President Trump's life, was he provided a full security complement akin to what a sitting U.S. president would receive?
He was provided a full complement of security based on the threat assessment that we had.
That's not my question.
And the venue.
My question is, if he'd been the sitting president, would he have had the same security he had on July 13th, or would have been beefed up?
There is a difference between the sitting president.
So your answer is he didn't.
And continuity of government and the responsibility that we
have. So he did not. Okay, there wasn't a CAT team, a full CAT team on site. There wasn't counter surveillance teams on site. But this is the thing. You just said you had the ability to beef up the security. You knew about the threat, and you didn't. And that's as telling as it is chilling. We have satellite images from the Butler Fairgrounds. Have you visited the site?
No, I have not.
9 days and you have not visited the site. You should have been there that night. Did you talk to that evening? Did you talk to the team, the heroes that surrounded the president? Did you call them that night?
They were still operational working.
So that's an answer no. Did you call them the next day?
The president. Yes, I spoke with
them. You called them the very next day, not the day of, or was it 72 hours after?
I don't know the timeline, but I spoke with
them.
Okay,
because you're under oath.
Immediately following.
I think it was 72 hours after. You waited 3 days. What is immediately clear is that there are a number of structures that need to be secured. Of these, Director, other than the first, immediate four, what's the most dangerous site that should have been secured? Because security 101, you got to mitigate the high ground.
Yes.
Okay. Do you know what the next most dangerous site, what was the closest structure to the president other than the four immediate ones that you had your counter sniper teams on?
There are a number of structures around that event site.
You know who the shooter knew? The shooter has visited the site two more times than you have, and he had a drone, and he picked the AGR building. So you said, do you remember in an ABC interview you did that you didn't have people on the roof of the AGR building because you were worried about safety because of the slope?
I recall that statement.
Okay. Does the Secret Service have written policy you can share with us about slope roofs?
No.
Okay. So why'd you act like there was one? Because is it your practice to comment on enormous events of enormous national implications when you're ignorant of the facts? That's rhetorical. So here's this thing with the slopes. You go all up to like 1812. You can go to a 112, which is about as flat as you can get without it being completely flat. And you're saying that there was a danger, safety concern there. But the problem is, Director, you put your counter snipers on a 312 roof, which is steeper than the 112. And by the way, the 112 is ADA compliant. You can build a ramp for a wheelchair on a 112 roof. So these are nothing but pathetic excuses, and they make no sense, and they're a bunch of cow dung. All the law enforcement I've spoken with over the last 9 days are amazed that the AGR rooftop was not secure. And you want to know why? Because it's dangerous. I have never had any long gun training in my life. I own an AR-15, and last time I shot it one time my whole life. It was 6 years ago. That is until Saturday, where we recreated the events in Savoy, Texas. We recreated what happened in Butler. I was lying prone on a slope roof at 130 yards at 6:30 at night. And I knew that he had a scope. I didn't know what kind, red dot or magnified. So I shot 8 rounds from both. You know what the result was? 15 out of 16 kill shots. And the one I missed would have hit the president's ear. That's a 94% success rate. And that shooter was a better shot than me. It is a miracle President Trump wasn't killed. Corey Compaiatore's life is over because that damn shooter made it on the roof. And it wasn't the roof that was dangerous. It was a nut job on top of the roof. You know what else is dangerous? I believe your horrifying ineptitude and your lack of skilled leadership is a disgrace. Your obfuscating today is shameful. And you should be fired immediately and go back to Garden Doritos. Mr. Chairman, I yield back.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'm going to continue down that vein. You have been here sitting today, Director Cheadle, definitively able to dismiss erroneous information and speculation. However, you are refusing to answer questions that we now know that you have the information for. You are saying that you are wanting to answer questions that the Secret Service has information to. Well, ma'am, you are the Secret Service. You are the director. You have said that you are the best for the job. So, I'm going to ask you some questions now knowing that you do have answers from the FBI, whom you have been passing the buck to this entire day. And I'll start with something that, you know, maybe the FBI doesn't know because it has to deal with you personally. You said you spoke with President Trump after the assassination attempt. And I want to know, did you apologize to him directly for nearly having President Trump killed?
Yes, I did.
I appreciate that. I appreciate that you recognize that this was your failure. Now, since the assassination attempt, you are under oath, reminding you, have you communicated with anyone at the White House on an encrypted messaging app like Signal? Yes or no?
No, I have not.
Are you willing to surrender your personal phone for analysis?
If I am required to do so.
Okay. I will look into making that request because I would like to see your personal phone to see if you're communicating over encrypted messaging apps. You excuse the roof being unmanned because of the slope. Do you stand by that assertion?
The roof was not covered with an individual on it because there was overwatch provided.
Apparently not. No, there was no overwatch provided. This is very evident. President Trump was shot. A man died. There was no oversight provided. I find this rather maddening, especially now knowing that you do have answers from the FBI, who you have been passing the buck to this entire hearing, not answering a congressional hearing, members of Congress, while you are under oath and under a subpoena. I find it maddening that the director, that our country has come centimeters away from oblivion under your watch. You have answers. You are refusing to give those to us, directing us to the FBI, and this entire thing is a waste of time. You are responsible for the loss of a life and the shooting that took place on President Trump. You do need to resign. This is bipartisan. You need to be fired. You do not need to hold this position. You are not the best for this job. I am over my time, but I cannot tolerate your watch any longer, and I'm going to continue to call daily for you to be removed from your position, ma'am.
Chair, I recognize Mr. Burchett from Tennessee.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Ms. Cheadle, the shooter was set up on the roof of the AGR International Building, as we know. Was the roof identified as a potential vulnerability days before the rally?
To my knowledge, yes, it was.
Were agents or officers inside the building? If so, what floor were they on?
We had local police officers inside the building.
The roof looks like it's a tin roof. How did no one inside that building hear someone moving on top of a metal roof?
I don't have the details of all of the interviews that have been conducted yet.
When will you have those?
I have been asking, and I want to have that information as soon as you do.
Okay.
As well.
Why did Secret Service fail to block the line of sight from that roof?
I think that the Secret Service put together a plan where they were counting that roof in as part of their overwatch, and that was the plan that they had put in place that day.
If you weren't going to put a security personnel on the roof, why not at least use drone technology or aerial surveillance to monitor the rally?
There are a number of times that we do use drone technology. I'm not speaking specifically to this event and what was utilized or not. There are times when drone technology is available and helpful at events, and there are times when it is not appropriate.
Do you personally use Signal to communicate with any official from the White House? Signal on your phone.
On occasion, I'm sure that there are people that use Signal, yes.
Okay. Do you use it to speak with the White House? Use Signal?
No, I do not.
Okay. When was Thomas Crooks first identified as a person of interest? Let me help you. At 5:10, he was spotted with a rangefinder at 5:51. When did Secret Service notice him?
Again, I don't have those specific timelines, but it was a relatively short period of time.
Let me help you. 5:52. Ms. Cheadle, why was President Trump allowed on stage 10 minutes after the Secret Service spotted a suspicious individual? That seems to me to be the worst thing of all. All the breakdown and all this communication, all the BS you've been feeding us here today or not feeding us, that seems to be the question.
So as I've stated before, there are a number of events where suspicious people may be identified. That doesn't necessarily...
Ma'am, I submit to you, you got a guy who's going to be the next president of the United States. He's on stage. I've been to these events. We've all been to these events. A car backfires, and there's a 15-minute dadgum wait. That's not acceptable. Did the Secret Service tell President Trump they'd spotted a suspicious individual before he was shot?
I am unclear as to what the communication was with the former president
I'll take that as a no. Did y'all deny President Trump's request for more security, yes or no? And when was the most recent request for additional security?
The rally request for security, all of those requests were fulfilled.
And were there any personnel redirected to Jill Biden's rally?
No.
Who made the decision on the direction of agents at either one of those rallies?
I'm unclear as to your question on the direction of the agents.
I said, who directed those agents to be at Ms. Biden's rally or President Trump's rally, the specific agents?
So there is a methodology in which agents are available for assignments, and they are assigned based on either geographic location or logistics or flight.
Ma'am, I appreciate all that, but that methodology about got President Trump killed. Was the security detail guarding President Trump a temporary detail?
The personnel who are assigned to the former president's detail are assigned to him.
Why was there a different detail on the opening night of the convention than the detail that was guarding him in Pennsylvania?
The president has a very large permanent protective detail assigned to him. They work shift work, and so it could be that the people you saw at the rally were not working the same shift the day that he was.
I can assure you, ma'am, somebody that's a lot shorter than the president was not at the convention, and the people that were cowering down behind the mass of agents that were on top of the president were not in the convention hall. At least I didn't see them. You can't seem to answer a single question about an ongoing investigation, ma'am, and you don't know when the information will be released publicly. Are you waiting for the administration to sign off?
No, I am waiting for the results of the investigation, at which time.
Okay. Let me ask you one more question. You found explosives in the shooter's possession. Is that correct?
The FBI found explosives.
Do we know who directed this young man how to make those explosives?
I believe that the FBI is still looking into that on their investigation.
Ms. Cheadle, you said that the buck stops with me, and I agree. I don't think you should resign. I think you should have been fired. Ma'am, you are a DEI horror story. I've told my daughter multiple times, my wife and my daughter, we talk to her all the time about how she's going to succeed in life. She'll succeed in life by achieving. Ma'am, you have not achieved today. You've let the American public down. If it was up to me, you'd be gone. Thank you, Mr. Speaker, Mr. Chairman.
answers. Most of my questions are going to demand a yes or no answer. Do you understand?
I do.
Okay, my first question. Both sides of the aisle today have asked for your resignation. Would you like to use my 5 minutes to draft your resignation letter, yes or no?
No, thank you.
Was this a colossal failure?
It was a failure.
Yes or no? Was it a colossal failure is the question, yes or no?
I have admitted this is a terrible
This is a failure. Yes or no series of questions. Was this a colossal failure, yes or no?
Yes.
Was this tragedy preventable, yes or no?
Yes.
Has the Secret Service been transparent with this committee?
Yes.
Would you say the fact that we had to issue a subpoena to get you to show up today as being transparent, yes or no?
I have always been
yes
eager to
or no. You didn't want to answer the question.
Committee.
We had to issue a subpoena to get you to show up today. That is not transparent, by the way. You stated earlier, Secret Service is not political. Is that correct?
Yes.
Okay. Would you say leaking your opening statement to Punchbowl News, Politico's Playbook, and Washington Post several hours before you sent it to this committee as being political, yes or no?
I have no idea how my statement got out.
Well, that's bullshit. So, Mr. Chairman, I would like to ask unanimous consent to enter into the record articles by Punchbowl News, Political Playbook, Washington Post, all done at 5:24 a.m., 6:12 a.m., 6:34 a.m., a solid 3 to 4 hours before this committee got your statement.
Without objection, so ordered.
Okay. Is the Secret Service fully cooperating with our committee?
Yes.
Okay, you say you're fully cooperating with this committee. On July 15th, this committee sent you a list of demands of information that we wanted. Has the Secret Service provided this committee a complete list of all law enforcement personnel that were there that day? Have you done that? Have you provided a list to the Oversight Committee? Yes or no?
I'll have to get back to you on that.
That is a no. Have you provided all audio and video recordings in your possession to this committee, as we asked on July 15th? Yes or no?
I would have to get back to you.
That is a no. You're full of shit today. You're just being completely dishonest.
Mr. Chairman,
I want to...
Mr.
Come on.
We have to maintain decorum in this committee, no matter how
upset we get. Have you provided any
and
all memos to this committee that we've asked you on July 15th? Have you provided all memorandums within the Secret Service?
I would have to get back to you on
that. That is a no. You are being dishonest or lying. You're being dishonest here with this committee. These are important questions that the American people want answers to, and you're just dodging and talking around it in generalities. And we had to subpoena you to be here, and you won't even answer the questions. We have asked you repeatedly to answer our questions. This isn't hard. These are not hard questions. Have you provided us all communications from the Secret Service related to that day and that rally? Have you provided this committee? We've asked for this information on July 15th. Have you provided any of this information that this committee has asked of the Secret Service, any of it?
I'll have to get back to you.
Have you even read this letter that we sent you? Did you even read this?
Yes.
Okay. And you have said you don't know, you have no idea. The answer is no. We haven't gotten a single document or piece of information or data from you or your agency in related to the rally that we have asked you for. So was this attempted assassination of Donald Trump a failure of training or execution or both?
I think that those are answers that we need to examine.
Training, execution, or both? Which one?
I think those are answers.
All right. How many Secret Service personnel have lost their jobs due to this colossal failure?
At this time, none.
How many Secret Service personnel have been required to take a refresher course on how not to let people shoot Donald Trump?
Our personnel are currently operational. We are examining the facts of this investigation, and we will make the changes necessary.
What time did law enforcement become aware that there was an individual on the roof with a clear line of sight to President Trump?
I am still verifying timelines.
Of course. 9 days in, you have no answers. How many minutes went by between the time law enforcement saw and took photos of Crooks and the shooting? How many minutes?
I am still verifying timelines.
57 minutes. Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and I yield back.
From Ohio.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Director, were you guessing or lying?
The day after President Trump is shot, Secret Service spokesman Anthony Guglielmi said, quote, the assertion that a member of the former president's security team requested additional security resources that the U.S. Secret Service or the Department of Homeland Security rebuffed is absolutely false. The next day, Secretary Mayorkas said, that is an unequivocally false assertion. We had not received any request for additional security measures that were rebuffed. But 5 days later, the Washington Post said this, top officials repeatedly rejected requests from Donald Trump's security detail for more personnel. The next day, the New York Times said this, Mr. Guglielmi acknowledged that the Secret Service had turned down some request for additional federal security assets for Mr. Trump's detail. So which is it? Because both statements can't be true. Were you guessing or lying when you said you didn't turn down requests from President Trump's detail?
Neither, sir, and I appreciate the question.
Well, what were you doing? Because those statements don't jive.
So what I can tell you is that for the event in Butler, there were no requests that were denied. As far as requests...
Well, maybe they got tired of asking. Maybe you turned them down so darn much they said, not worth asking. How many times did you turn them down ahead of that?
I think that it is important to distinguish between what some people may view as a denial of an asset or a request.
Well, is Mr. Guglielmi your spokesperson? He said he acknowledged the Secret Service had turned down some requests. I'm asking how many?
A denial of a request does not equal a vulnerability.
Well, tell me what it is.
There are a number of ways that threats and risks can be mitigated with a number of different assets, whether that be through personnel, whether that be through technology, or resources.
Well, tell the committee which it was. They asked for additional help in some form or another. You told them no. How many times did you tell them no, and what did you tell them no to?
Again, I cannot speak to specific incidents, but I can tell you in general terms, the Secret Service is judicious with their resources based on...
What does some request mean? How many times? Some indicate requests is plural. So more than once they asked for additional help and you turned them down. What did they ask for and how many times did you turn them down? Pretty basic questions.
So again, without having all of the details in front of me, sir, what I can tell you is that there are times...
You didn't get briefed on how many times you turned down the Trump detail when they asked for additional help?
I'm sorry.
You didn't get briefed on that before you came to this hearing knowing you were going to get asked that question?
What I can tell you is that in generic terms, when details make a request... There are times that there are alternate ways to cover off on that threat or that risk.
But that's not what he said. He said they were denied certain requests, requests. This is your spokesperson, not me talking. This is the Secret Service talking. What a change from absolutely false, unequivocally false to, oh, by the way, there were some times where we didn't give them what they wanted. That's a huge change in 5 days. And the fact that you can't answer how many times you did that, that's pretty darn frustrating, not just for me, but for the country.
I hear your frustration.
Let me ask you this. Were any of those requests denied to President Trump's detail after you knew about the Iranian threat?
What I can tell you, again, I don't know the specifics, is that there are times when we can fill a request. It doesn't necessarily have to be with a Secret Service asset or resource. We can fill that request with locally available assets.
You spoke to anyone at the White House since July 13th?
Yes, I have.
Who'd you talk to?
I have briefed the president and the vice president.
Talk to the first lady?
No, I have not.
Talk to the White House staff? Anyone in the White House communications?
No, I have not.
Have you talked to the counter sniper who took the shot that took out the bad guy?
Yes, I have.
And can you tell us about that conversation?
I would not want to reveal conversations that I've had with my employees.
But that's exactly the kind of information the American people want to know. American people who pay your salary.
I understand. This is an ongoing investigation.
Who's all doing the investigating at Secret Service? I know the Inspector General, but is there also an internal investigation in addition to the Inspector General?
We are conducting a mission assurance investigation internally, yes.
You know what it looks like, Director? It looks like you won't answer some pretty basic questions. It looks like you got a 9% raise and you cut corners when it came to protecting one of the most important individuals, most well-known individuals on the planet. A former president, likely the guy who's going to be the next president. Looks like you guys were cutting corners. That's what it looks like to me. Is that true?
I am here today because I want to answer questions, but I also want to be cautious.
You might want to, but you haven't answered. I don't think you've answered one question from the chairman, the ranking member, or me. Well, we got a lot of other people asking. We'll see if your record improves. But right now, you haven't answered, I don't think, any questions. I yield back.
Drone over the area, period. Any part of the area.
Again, I would have to go back and check the timeline of when that took place and when the event.
Why didn't you bring the timeline with you today to answer our questions?
I don't have all of the answers on the timelines based on the criminal investigation.
Were you not prepared today to answer our questions?
I am prepared to answer the questions based on the information and wanted to be able to provide.
Do you have a timeline from any of the day?
I have a timeline that does not have specifics.
That's shocking. That is absolutely unacceptable. That means you are a failure at your job.
Neutralize them.
How were people in the crowd? Okay, then let's just take it this way. People under your command did not consider him to be a threat, yet people in the crowd knew he had a gun and considered him to be a threat. That means that you are a complete failure as the director of the Secret Service, that people under your command don't perceive a man laying on a roof with direct line to the president with a gun. They don't perceive that to be a threat, yet the people in the crowd do. How is that possible?
That's the last question, but please answer the question, Ms. Director.
I'm not certain at this time how the information from the people in the crowd was relayed to any law enforcement personnel.
No, you knew, that everyone knew. The people there knew that there was a danger. They knew there was a threat to President Trump, and it was allowed to happen. Was there a stand-down order, Ms. Cheadle? No. Was there a conspiracy to kill President Trump?
Absolutely not.
Then how did this happen? And why are you still sitting here not turning in your letter of resignation?
Last question, but please answer, and then I'll recognize Ms. Presley. Please answer that question.
Director. That is what we are investigating to determine.
We're waiting for your letter. We are waiting for your letter of resignation, and you really need to consider doing that before you leave.
Representative Boebert asked earlier about using encrypted apps that you said you've not used, I guess, Signal. Have you used any encrypted app to communicate from your personal device?
I do on occasion use encrypted apps to communicate.
So you use some form of an encrypted app to communicate with people within the federal government, with local law enforcement? Whom are you communicating using the encrypted apps?
Many times it's with colleagues and associates.
So you're communicating with colleagues on a personal device?
There are times that the Secret Service, when we work internationally with some of our partners, that they don't have the same texting capability.
And you're not able to do that with your government-issued device?
Recently, we have been able to install some of those apps on government devices.
Okay. Let's talk about some of the things that we can get access to. I'm actually shocked that you are using your personal device and encrypted communication tools. I think that might be the most shocking thing that I've heard today. I didn't expect for you to say that.
A simple answer. The ubiquity of guns, dangerous weapons in America, like AR-15s, has that made your job, that is to say the mission of the Secret Service, easier or more difficult?
I think the threat environment for protecting our Secret Service protectees is always difficult, and that's dynamic and it's always evolving.
We stipulate it's always difficult. Again, this is a simple one. Does the ubiquity of guns make your job easier or more difficult today?
I understand the Second Amendment rights of individuals.
I didn't ask that question. I'm not questioning the Second Amendment. I'm asking a simple analysis, Director Cheadle. And I can tell you, you're not making my job easier in terms of assessing your qualification for continuing on as director. Please answer the question. You're the head of the Secret Service. You're speaking on behalf of 8,000 members who put their lives on the line. We just had a failure by your own admission. Do guns make your job easier or harder?
I think the job of the Secret Service is difficult on every day, and we need to make sure that we are mitigating
all threats, whether that be
that
weapons,
isn't my question.
Personnel.
That is not my question. And now I think you're evading the answer, which is not a hard one.
I am sorry that you feel that way, sir.
How else could I feel?
...that are happening in about 100 days. So the notion of a report coming out in 60 days when the threat environment is so high in the United States, irrespective of party, is not acceptable. And I think it's very important to understand that. This is not theater. This is not about jockeying. This is about the safety of some of the most highly targeted and valued targets internationally and domestically in the United States of America. So the idea that a report will be finalized in 60 days, let alone prior to any actionable decisions that would be made, is simply not acceptable. It has been 10 days since an assassination attempt on a former president of the United States, regardless of party. There need to be answers.
Now, Director Cadel, would you agree that this is the most serious security lapse since President Reagan was shot in 1981 of the Secret Service?
Yes, sir, I would.
And, you know, do you know what Stuart Knight did when he was in charge at the time of the Secret Service? Do you know what he did afterwards?
He remained on duty.
He resigned. He resigned. And Stuart Knight was not a Democratic appointee or a Republican appointee. Look, I'm not questioning your judgment. I just don't think this is partisan. If you have an assassination attempt on a president, a former president, or a candidate, you need to resign. That's what Stuart Knight did. He was a Republican appointee, and he took responsibility. And I think you need to reflect. This is not a question of you. It's a question of the American people. You cannot go leading a Secret Service agency when there is an assassination attempt on a presidential candidate.
You know what else is dangerous? I believe your horrifying ineptitude and your lack of skilled leadership is a disgrace. Your obfuscating today is shameful, and you should be fired immediately and go back to Garden Doritos. Mr. Chairman, I yield back.
The venue.
My question is, if he'd been the sitting president, would he have had the same security he had on July 13th or would have been beefed up?
There is a difference between the sitting president.
So your answer is he didn't.
And continuity of government okay. And the responsibility
that
we have.
So he did not. Okay, there wasn't a CAT team, the full CAT team on site. There wasn't counter.
You know what it looks like, Director? It looks like you won't answer some pretty basic questions. It looks like you got a 9% raise and you cut corners when it came to protecting one of the most important individuals, most well-known individuals on the planet. A former president, likely the guy's going to be the next president. Looks like you guys were cutting corners. That's what it looks like to me. Is that true?
I am here today because I want to answer questions. But I also want to be cautious.
You might want to, but you haven't answered. I don't think you've answered one question from the chairman, the ranking member, or me. Well, we got a lot of other people asking. We'll see if your record improves. But right now, you haven't answered, I don't think, any questions. I yield back.
Hey, bonjour tout le monde. J'espère que vous avez apprécié ce montage historique. Ça arrivera pas 10 fois dans votre vie qu'un président va vivre un complot contre sa vie. C'est la 6e fois. Sur 45 présidents, 4 morts, 2 vivants. Ronald Reagan, c'est le seul rescapé à part Donald Trump. Donc, j'ai écouté les 5 heures pour vous. J'ai résumé ça en 40 minutes. Dans les 40 minutes, vous avez le gros de la viande. Et j'ai pris des notes pour vous. Évidemment, très important de mettre un like si vous avez apprécié mon travail. Ça fait à peu près 10-11 jours que je travaille d'arrache-pied pour vous, minimum 12 heures par jour à faire des montages, à faire de l'infographie, à faire de la revue d'information. C'est grâce à ça que je suis capable de vous sortir autant de contenu très rapidement. Je suis le seul qui le fait au Québec. À ce niveau-là, vous avez autant d'informations. Il n'y en a pas. Il n'y en a pas. Donc, le résumé de l'audience de Kimberly Chattel, la directrice des services secrets. Donc, du 22 juillet 2024. 22 juillet 2024. Donc, Elle ne répond pas aux questions. Premièrement, elle se cache derrière les enquêtes du FBI pour dire « je veux pas mettre de l'entrave, mettre des obstacles à l'enquête ». On a entendu tout le monde des deux côtés, les deux parties veulent sa démission. Il y a même un des représentants qui a dit « qu'est-ce qui est arrivé au gars directeur des services secrets ?» responsable de la tentative contre Ronald Reagan, il a démissionné le jour même. Donc la pression était très forte. Ils ont même dit on allait signer une lettre. Et il y a le congressiste Moscovitz, un démocrate. Il a dit « Things aren't going well for you ». Il a dit « On n'est pas là pour te chier dessus, mais il faut que tu nous aides un peu. Aide-nous à t'aider. Je sais pas qui t'a briefé pour te préparer à ce que tu vis présentement, mais ton comportement, ton faciès, la manière que tu réponds aux questions, qu'est-ce que tu dis en répondant aux questions, les réponses, le contenu, le contenant, tout est à chier. Ça marche pas. Ça marche pas. Ça, évidemment, c'est le bon côté, correct des démocrates. Il y a le côté, évidemment, plus partisan qui ont utilisé pendant toute la séance la tentative d'assassinat contre Donald Trump pour dire qu'il fallait bannir les AR-15, des armes d'assaut, qu'ils disaient. Et ensuite de ça, évidemment, ils ont aussi martelé le message partisan pro-Kamala Harris. Les républicains sont des masculinistes, anti-féministes, anti-diversité, équité, inclusion. Et la diversité, équité, inclusion au service secret n'a pas du tout affecté la couverture de protection du président. C'est un mensonge. C'est des anti-féministes, c'est des masculinistes toxiques qui font ça. C'est de la désinformation. Qu'est-ce qu'on a eu d'autre? Kimberly Chattel a mentionné de biais la continuité du gouvernement. Et là, il n'y a personne qui a relevé ça, à part les Morris de Redacted, Clayton et Nathalie Morris. Moi aussi, je l'avais entendu. Qu'est-ce qu'on a aussi? Ah! En débutant l'audience, ils ont honoré la congressiste démocrate responsable du oversight des services secrets qui s'appelle, je me rappelle pas son nom, mais qui est morte le 17 juillet 2024, 4 jours après la tentative d'assassinat contre Donald Trump. La représentante démocrate qui regarde qu'est-ce que les services secrets font, donc qui a accès, elle meurt. On a eu Kimberly Chattel qui a dit « J'ai un timeline. I have a timeline that does not have specifics. J'ai un timeline sans fait spécifique. Sans donner de temps, sans étendre de temps spécifique. Donc j'ai un timeline sans les événements, en tout cas. Donc, dans la salle, ça le rit. Ça, c'était Marjorie Taylor Greene qui a posé la question. C'était très beaucoup de choc dans cette interview-là, cette audience-là. On a aussi appris qu'on n'allait pas savoir le fin mot de l'histoire pendant 2 mois. Donc, Kimberly Chattel a refusé de dévoiler quelconque fait qu'elle entravait l'enquête en cours, jusqu'à temps que l'enquête en cours soit terminée. Et, quand on a posé la question, combien de temps? 60 jours. Donc, 60 jours à partir du 13, donc il reste encore 50 jours. Ça s'appelle de la temporisation quand on parle d'opérations sur le terrain clandestine, ou militaire, ou peu importe. Autre détail intéressant, durant toute l'audience, Kimberly Chattel dit qu'elle n'a pas utiliser d'applications de communication encryptées, mais à la toute fin, elle dit que dans sa vie privée, pour communiquer avec des collègues, elle le fait. Comment tu fais la différence entre des communications privées et professionnelles sur une application encryptée? Expliquez-moi ça dans le chat. Moi, je ne sais pas. Donc, est-ce que vous avez aimé ma petite couverture, mon petit résumé? On continue avec des breaking news! Oui, parce que pendant que le montage jouait, je continuais ma veille d'informations et j'arrive avec des breaking news. On a la campagne de Donald Trump qui remplit des plaintes judiciaires contre donc à la FEC, la commission des élections, contre Biden et Kamala Harris qui violeraient évidemment les lois de financement électoral à cause du procédé électoral que je vous ai expliqué avant le montage. Donc, tout va bien, ça se fait en temps réel à la Révolution culturelle avec Yann Rushdi. On apprend aussi en temps réel ce soir, confirmation par Paul Sperry, journaliste chevronné de Real Clear Investigation, columniste de New York Post, qui explique que c'est Jake Sullivan, celui qui a peddlé le Russiagate contre Donald Trump dans la campagne de Hillary Clinton en 2016, c'est lui qui a piloté le cover-up de l'état de santé de Biden depuis 2020, depuis le début de sa présidence, depuis la fin. Parce que il n'a pas fait de campagne électorale en 2020. Il était déjà sénile et dément. Donc pendant 4 ans, on a fait semblant d'avoir un président. C'est succulent. Autre breaking news, 7h16 ce soir. Des hackers ont pénétré dans Leidos Holding Incorporé, un des plus larges services de technologie IT qu'on appelle ça, c'est le service client quand tu as des dépannages. Pour le gouvernement américain, dans les clients de Leidos, ça inclut le Pentagone, le département Homeland Security et NASA. La même semaine qu'un effondrement CrowdStrike. Et 10 jours après une tentative d'assassinat contre Donald Trump. Et le même jour de l'abdication de Joe Biden. Hey, il se passe-tu des affaires, mesdames et messieurs, en temps réel, avec vous? Donc, ah oui, j'avais oublié de remercier les dons qu'on a eus. François Garceau, 10$ et Gaël Porto, 5$. Donc, pour l'instant, François Aubé me doit 15. Envoyez les super chats pour faire sortir le cash. Faire cracher le cash à François Aubé Construction, FA Construction Commerciale, hotmail.ca, pour des contrats de rénovation virilistes. Donc, Kimberly Chittle qui stonewall durant son témoignage. Qu'est-ce qu'on a ici? Donc ça, c'est ce matin, avant que Kimberly Chittle annonce officiellement sa démission. Donc les services secrets, le FBI, Homeland Security refusent tout subpoena à partir d'aujourd'hui ce matin. Donc il n'y a plus personne au gouvernement qui veut discuter avec le Congrès pour essayer d'avoir le fin mot de l'histoire de ce complot dans l'assassinat de Donald Trump. Donc ça, c'est James Comer et le démocrate Jamie Raskin, le ranking member qu'on appelle. Donc il y a tout le temps le chairman, puis le ranking member, au moins un ranking member qui est du camp opposé. Donc les deux signent une lettre demandant la démission de Kimberly Chittle. Voici la lettre en question. Donc ça, c'est évidemment, c'est du symbolique, mais c'est du symbolique qui fait de la pression de communication. Pression au niveau bureaucratique. Nancy Mace, que François Aubé n'aime pas tant. Sarah Taleb, 5$ pour mon Yann tout beau. Merci beaucoup, ma belle. Donc, Nancy Mace qui remplit une motion pour impeacher Kim Chittle, directrice des services secrets. Donc, en même temps que la... ça, c'était hier soir. Qu'est-ce qu'on a eu d'autre ici? Lanceur d'alerte qui confirme qu'il y avait des agents des services secrets qui surveillaient le toit où était l'assaillant qui a tiré sur Donald Trump. Crooks. Le Oversight Project qui confirme ce matin, enfin en matinée, 10h le matin, que Kimberly Chattel annonçait sa démission par courriel. Et là, on rentre dans la conspiration XXL. Donc, les données cellulaires ont été sorties par la fondation Heritage Oversight Project. Donc, Heritage Foundation, c'est anciennement des néoconservateurs qui sont en train de pivoter du côté America First. Lentement. Anti-woke. Donc, c'est un think tank anciennement néoconservateur, chrétien, qui a basculé dans les factions pro-Trumpistes, comme Elon Musk. Donc, c'est pas, ce sont pas nos représentants, mais ce sont des alliés idéologiques dans cette guerre culturelle et civilisationnelle contre les pédosatanistes! Donc, des données cellulaires sur les devices, les cellulaires et autres engins technologiques en possession de Thomas Crook. Et on a des détails donc sur qu'est-ce qui s'est passé avec ces engins. On a découvert en fait que Crook avait deux cellulaires plus son détonateur. Ça fait trois engins. Et là, il y a d'autres engins qui se rajoutent. On est jusqu'à 9 devices, des téléphones, des laptops, des tablettes, localisés au domicile de Crooks et à son lieu de travail dans l'année passée, en utilisant donc des données qu'on peut acheter via les agents marketing. Et c'est pour ça que vous devriez utiliser un VPN. Et c'est pour ça que j'ai besoin de vous pour trouver un vendeur de VPN que je vais pouvoir, qui va commanditer mon podcast. Et donc, on va pouvoir utiliser le hashtag ou le bon révolution culturelle ou virilisme pour avoir 10% de rabais pour un VPN. En tout cas, parce que on peut vous suivre de bien des manières quand on regarde qu'est-ce que vous consommez sur les réseaux sociaux et où vous allez avec vos big data. Donc, jusqu'à 9 trucs, cellulaires, tablettes, laptops. Et il y a aussi des croisements intéressants entre les appareils de Crooks et un individu qui a visité régulièrement Thomas Crooks à sa maison et au travail. Un même individu qui va à un building à Washington, D.C., proche des bureaux du FBI en juin 2023. Donc, on voit les deux cercles ici, proche du centre, un peu vers le haut puis la droite. C'est quand même proche. C'est quand même proche. Donc, il se passe des choses intéressantes à ce niveau-là. C'est ça, des connexions avec des gens qui sont proches des bureaux du FBI. C'est le Oversight Project sur Twitter, si vous voulez aller voir ces données-là. Ensuite de ça, il y a des journalistes indépendants comme Eli Crane qui sont allés sur les lieux, tandis que Kim Chattel n'a toujours pas été sur les lieux. Donc, on voit ici où était le tireur, l'assaillant. Donc, on voit le toit avec une pente monstrueuse, impossible, impraticable pour des snipers aguerris. Trop dangereux. On pourrait se briser une cheville, littéralement. Pas fouler, briser, casser la cheville. Paf! En deux. Fracture ouverte. trop dangereux. En plus, ça devait, avec le soleil, il devait faire chaud là-dessus, là. Ça, il devait être comme de la lave. Alors, trop dangereux. Trop dangereux. Je sais pas comment Crooks a été capable de ramper, de se mettre en position pour tirer sur Donald Trump ainsi. C'est impossible. Autre détail intéressant. Les journalistes en question ont découvert qu'il y avait une fenêtre pour regarder directement le toit en question. Donc, malheureusement, on voit ici que probablement qu'ils l'ont laissé ramper l'autre bord de la pente du toit. Donc, je vais le laisser rejouer ici, là. Donc, on voit là, on voit pas l'autre bord de la pente. Ça, c'est juste le bout, c'est juste le milieu du toit. Donc, probablement qu'ils ont jugé que Crooks était suspicieux et non pas menaçant, même s'il y avait probablement un gun avec lui. Et là, il a traversé la pente. Et là, quand il a commencé à se préparer pour tirer, les personnes qui étaient dans le building et qui avaient le toit devant eux ne voyaient pas le gun et il a tiré. Donc, c'est de la haute négligence slash de la trahison. Donc, on voit ici la représentante démocrate Shayla Jackson. C'est elle qui était en charge du oversight des services secrets pour les démocrates. Et c'est elle qui est morte. Et elle a une bague intéressante. Est-ce que vous reconnaissez le symbole de sa bague? Qui est très spécial. C'est pas un symbole qu'on voit souvent. Dan Bongino, ancien agent des services secrets, qui confirme de son bord qu'il y avait un troisième tireur. Donc, il y avait trois tireurs différents. Donc, il y a de plus en plus de gens qui sont de cette position-là. Moi, je ne suis pas encore tranché. Je vous mets toutes les informations devant vous en temps réel. Moi, ce que je fais en général dans ce genre de scénario-là, c'est des probabilités. Hein? Vous me connaissez rendu ici, je ne donne pas vraiment de... Quand je suis capable de dire que c'est vrai à 100%, c'est parce qu'il y a assez de preuves pour arriver à ça. Donc, quand on est arrivé au point que j'avais une vidéo de la trajectoire de la balle passant à travers l'oreille de Trump et les deux victimes et le bras hydraulique, la machine derrière Trump, la ligne est parfaite avec le son. Il n'y a rien là. Mais il y a des petits détails intéressants sur les tirs en question qui tendent à confirmer qu'il y aurait un troisième tireur dans la tour d'eau, dans le château d'eau, dans le Water Fort. Donc, la représentante Anna Paulina Luna, qui est de l'avis de tout le monde que Crooks n'a pas travaillé tout ça. Le sénateur Ron Johnson a rendu public ce matin un rapport d'enquête préliminaire sur la tentative d'assassinat. Les key findings. Donc, les services secrets n'ont pas envoyé de sniper pour protéger le toit en question, pour occuper le toit. Les services secrets n'ont pas participé au briefing de sécurité clé pour l'événement. Crooks a été capable d'utiliser un drone le jour de l'événement. Les équipes de sécurité locale avaient isolé leur communication. Donc, il y avait des problèmes de communication entre les différentes équipes sur les lieux. Les services secrets confirment qu'il y a eu plusieurs tips pour dire que Crooks était suspect sur les lieux. À 5h41, donc une demi-heure avant les tirs en question, le sniper numéro 1 a rapporté le suspect. Ensuite de ça, des photos ont été prises et envoyées pour reconnaissance faciale par un policier. Donc ça, c'est tout ce qui a été validé par le sénateur Ron Johnson en une journée d'enquête. Donc on rappelle que la directrice des services secrets a eu 9 journées d'enquête et elle a été incapable d'accoucher d'un rapport préliminaire. Donc c'est pour ça qu'elle a perdu sa job. Et là, donc, c'est ça. Là, on va rajouter une couche de complotistes avant les sorcières de la semaine. Vous êtes prêts pour les sorcières de la semaine? C'est un sorcière de la semaine intense, cette semaine. Donc, Eric Prince, le fondateur de Blackwater, a écrit sur Twitter. Et il n'a pas effacé son tweet. Le sniper qui a tiré, le contre-sniper qui a tiré sur l'assaillant de Trump, donc le contre-sniper qui a tiré sur le sniper, a fait un shot de 488 yards. Si on fait la télémétrie, la distance en utilisant l'acoustique et le GPS, il y a un seul endroit qui peut arriver à la distance de 488 yards et c'est le château d'eau, le Waterford. Très intéressant. Pendant l'audience de Kimberly Chettle, au moment où les représentants républicains ont posé des questions sur un deuxième tireur présumé contre Trump, les réseaux de médias mainstream qui présentaient une diffusion des audiences ont interrompu la diffusion en question. Marjorie Taylor Greene, ce matin ou hier soir, est allée chez InfoWars pour confirmer le complot. Donc, encore plus de pression. Ensuite de ça, qu'est-ce qu'on a ici? Autre complot. CrowdStrike. Donc, au moment où CrowdStrike a effacé des données le mercredi 17 juillet 2024 et causé une panne mondiale, il y a quelqu'un qui a shorté l'entreprise et fait une fortune. C'est un événement probabilistique de 7 sigma. C'est l'équivalent de flipper pile ou face du bon côté, de ton côté, 25 fois de suite. C'est impossible. Donc, il y a quelqu'un qui savait que CrowdStrike allait causer une panne mondiale. Donc, un bet de 2,3 millions de dollars qui va exploser dans un prix fou. Probablement que ça va être il va faire quelque chose comme des centaines de millions de dollars sur le prix de vente de son short. Donc, il y a Chris Martinson qui est sur le dossier de la fraude de délit d'initié de CrowdStrike. Et on a des données de cellulaire en lien avec ça. Donc, probablement que le complot va plus loin qu'on pourrait croire. Autre couche de complotisme. Donc, il y a l'histoire de l'homme au suit gris, qui est supposément un agent du Alcohol Tobacco Firearm, donc l'agence ATF, qui est arrivé sur les lieux après la tentative d'assassinat, qui a monté sur le toit où Crooks était mort. Ensuite de ça, qui est allé voir les policiers et leur a demandé de prendre des photos du cadavre et de l'envoyer à son cellulaire. Donc, les gens se posent comme question, mais pourquoi il n'a pas pris son cellulaire pour prendre lui-même les photos? Ben, c'est parce qu'il n'avait pas son cellulaire avec lui, parce qu'il ne voulait pas être suivi. Pourquoi cet agent fédéral ne souhaitait pas être suivi? Donc, beaucoup de couches de complot. Beaucoup de couches de complot. Donald Trump a revendiqué que cette tentative d'assassinat contre lui a renforcé fortement sa foi. Et après tout ce qu'on voit présentement, on peut être certain que il y a eu un complot et que c'est pas juste une coïncidence. Si vous croyez pas au miracle après ce que vous avez vu, rendu ici, vous croirez jamais au miracle. On a vu un miracle. C'est ça qui est arrivé. C'est la somme de toutes les peurs, le scénario du film, il est arrivé. On allait vers la guerre mondiale, et là, la balle à point, à un quart de pouce près, a évité la guerre mondiale, et là, nous sommes en train de changer d'humeur sociétale. Il y a un courant trumpiste inarrêtable. Est-ce que ce courant va être capable de détruire comme un tsunami la fraude électorale massive qui est en construction avec l'aide de la horde de morts vivants? Donc, je suis en train de faire la transition présentement, pendant que je suis en train de faire de l'actualité. C'est pas merveilleux. Le Rush 10 n'a pas d'opposition, mes amis. Donc, on a un homme de 22 ans qui se repentit d'avoir été possédé au point de tuer un partisan trumpiste de 80 ans. Donc ça ressemble à la possession, mes amis. Donc, le gars, il voit un vieux monsieur trumpiste en train de mettre des pancartes de Trump, MAGA, sur sa cour. Il s'ostine avec lui, il s'engueule, il tape sa gueule et il le tue. Et donc, c'est à ça que ça ressemble à la possession. Donc, le dude en question s'est repenti, il a appelé la police et il s'est suicidé parce qu'il savait qu'il allait en prison. Donc, nous sommes en train de vivre quelque chose d'historique, je vous le répète, à chaque podcast depuis des semaines maintenant. Le comité de la Chambre des représentants diffuse des nouvelles, des milliers d'heures de footage du 6 janvier 2021 parce qu'il y a encore des gens en prison et en procès, faussement accusés d'insurrection en lien avec cette histoire-là. C'est toujours d'actualité. Et dernière nouvelle avant les sorcières de la semaine et la horde de morts-vivants aux Jeux olympiques, on a Steve Bannon et les America First qui sont en train de préparer avec la Chambre des représentants un brief judiciaire qui va faire ressortir au niveau bureaucratique, procéduriel, ça va faire ressortir que le comité du 6 janvier 2021 était inconstitutionnel et illégitime. Donc que pendant 4 ans, on a eu des occupants qui ont construit un tribunal populaire illégitime pour envoyer des opposants politiques en prison et les torturer. Donc, les gens qui ont siégé sur ce comité-là, si ça passe, et si Trump prend le pouvoir, on va avoir des procès pour haute trahison, selon moi. Donc, êtes-vous prêts pour les sorcières de la semaine? Si vous appréciez mes montages, motivez-moi et faites sortir faites sortir le cash à François Aubé. Envoyez les super chats. J'ai hâte. À tantôt. Et bonne semaine. On se voit en fin de semaine.
Welcome the next president of the United States, Donald J. Trump.
You already know. The world ain't all sunshine and rainbows. It's a very mean and nasty place, and I don't care how tough you are, it will beat you to your knees and keep you there permanently if you let it. You, me, or nobody is gonna hit as hard as life. But it ain't about how hard you hit. It's about how hard you can get hit and keep moving forward. How much you can take and keep moving forward. That's how winning is done.
Hey,
Is it safe to say that based off of your comments, you're suggesting that these women at these abortion rallies are ugly and overweight?
Yes.
What do you say to people who think that those comments are offensive?
Be offended. Mm-hmm.
I was just going to say, I'm actually personally surprised that it had that much temporary cavity, that much expansion.
But notice how the head is still pink.
Yeah. Yeah, if you play it all in full speed, it's like, well, that's very unfucking impressive.
Right. But
that is only your party which is saying that they voted against the bill and they don't want to support this bill, C-381. What is the reason why they are not supporting it?
Because Justin Trudeau is a wacko. That's it.
Okay.
That's the answer. You have a wacko for a prime minister.
Don't think twice about messing with Trump.
Yeah.
Don't think twice.
Okay.
And pro Biden can't make it up the stairs. And obviously he's stepped out of the race. But it's nobody's going to be intimidated by Biden. It's impossible. I think they will be intimidated by a guy who was fist pumping after getting shot.
Some rumblings of that on X this week. It can be something that's very difficult to get done, but it is possible. The Justice Department holds about 200,000 units of Bitcoin, so the United States is the largest holder of Bitcoin. And so they could easily just move that over to the Department of Treasury and start right there and have $13 billion worth of Bitcoin on the balance sheet. So it is a possible move, it just could be tough to get done. But what happens is the Justice Department is holding these units of Bitcoin. They've been a random seller in the space. And so if they move from being a random seller at times, which could push the price of Bitcoin down, over to being a long-term hodler, well, that could be really good for the space and push prices up.
The government.
Thank you, transgender. Thank you, transgender.
Government. No, I'm not. I don't know.
Hey, get out of here, man. What the hell? Jesus Christ with these lunatic Republicans.